In the previous video, we introduced the idea of the equivalent voltage and the equivalent current. Actually, the ratio of the voltage to the current is equivalent to the impedance. So, in this video, we are going to discuss the concept of impedance in microwave circuits. Actually, we have different types of impedances. The first type is the intrinsic impedance. The intrinsic impedance of the medium is actually the ratio of the transverse electric field to the transverse magnetic field in transverse electromagnetic waves propagating inside this medium. And this intrinsic impedance of the medium is a characteristic of the medium, and it equals square root mu over epsilon. And usually it has a notation eta. So eta, which equals the square root mu over epsilon, is the intrinsic impedance of the medium. This impedance is dependent only on the material parameters of the medium and is equal to the wave impedance of the plane wave. Another impedance is the wave impedance in the waveguide. The wave impedance in the waveguide corresponds to the ratio of the transverse field component to the transverse magnetic field component. So ZW equals E transverse over H transverse. And in terms of the wave admittance, it equals 1 over the wave admittance. This impedance is a characteristic of a particular type of wave. It can be used for transverse electromagnetic, transverse magnetic, or transverse electric wave. And each have different wave impedance, which depend on the type of the line or the guide, in addition to the material inside the waveguide and the operating frequency. So the wave impedance of the guiding structure depend on the type of the mode, depends on the geometry of the waveguide, depends on the dielectric medium of the waveguide. The third type of impedance is the characteristic impedance of transmission line, Z0. Z0 is the relation between the voltage on the current to the transmission line to the current in the transmission line. So the characteristic impedance Z0 is related to voltage to current. And the reciprocal of the characteristic impedance is the characteristic admittance. So Z0 characteristic impedance equals 1 over Y0, where Y0 is the characteristic admittance. And as we say, characteristic impedance is the ratio of the voltage to the current of a traveling wave on a transmission line. For the case of transverse electromagnetic waves, this ratio is constant and unique for a specific transmission line. But for the case of transverse electric or transverse magnetic modes, there is no unique value for the characteristic impedance. In this case, we are going to use what we have said, equivalent voltage and equivalent current. That's what we are seeing. Because voltage and current are uniquely defined for transverse electromagnetic waves, the characteristic impedance of a transverse electromagnetic wave is unique. However, for the case of transverse electric and transverse magnetic waves, we don't have a unique definition for the voltage and current. So the characteristic impedance for such wave may be defined in different ways. As an example, consider a rectangular waveguide with a width A equals 2.286 cm and B equals 1.016 cm, which is X-band waveguide. Actually, this type of guide is WR90. Airfield for Z less than 0. So this bar is airfield. And Rolex failed with epsilon r 2.54 for z greater than 0. So the waveguide is filled with dielectric medium with epsilon r 2.54 for z greater than 0. If the operating frequency is 10 GHz, use an equivalent transmission line model to compute the reflection coefficient of TE10 mode wave incident on the interface from z less than 0. This means that we have an incident wave at z less than 0, and because the wave impedance in the airfield waveguide is different from the wave impedance from the dielectric field waveguide, we have a reflection coefficient. So it is required to determine the reflection coefficient. Actually, we can determine this reflection coefficient by using full wave analysis. But instead of using full wave analysis, we are going to use equivalent transmission line network. This means that we are going to represent the airfield waveguide by a transmission line section with a characteristic impedance Z0A. And the dielectric loaded waveguide by another transmission line section of a characteristic impedance Z0D. This means that I have a semi-infinite transmission line of a characteristic impedance Z0A loaded by an impedance Z0D. This means that the reflection coefficient, it would be Z0D minus Z0A over Z0D over plus Z0D. This from the transmission line tail. The question now, what will be the value of Z0A and Z0D? Z0A and Z0D would correspond to the TE wave impedance of the transmission line for the two cases. The first case when it is airfield, and second case from and when it is dielectric. When it is airfield, the TE wave impedance is k naught eta naught over beta a, where beta a is the propagation constant when it is filled with air. Beta a equals the square root k naught squared minus pi over a squared, assuming that we are talking about TE10 mode. And k naught is actually omega squared c. Omega is 2 by f, and the frequency is 10 GHz. So we can calculate the value of k naught, 2 by f over c, is 209.4 meter to the power minus 1. And the value of a is the 2.286 centimeters. We should convert it to meters to be an MKS unit. So we can obtain the value of beta A. In a similar way, we can find the propagation constant in the dielectric field waveguide. In the case of the dielectric field waveguide, we are going to replace k naught squared by k squared. K squared is epsilon r k naught squared. And epsilon r in this case is 2.54. So this is a propagation constant inside the waveguide filled with the dielectric medium, and this value would be 304.1 meters to the power minus 1. From the propagation constant in the air and the propagation constant in the dielectric, we obtain the wave impedance in the air part field waveguide and the wave impedance in the dielectric field waveguide. Here it is k naught eta naught over beta a. Here it is k eta over beta dielectric. And because k is omega square root mu epsilon and eta is square root mu over epsilon, the effect of epsilon r here can be eliminated. So k eta is actually k naught eta naught, because we are using non-magnetic material. From this, we have the wave impedance of the air field waveguide, and the wave impedance of the dielectric field waveguide. From the concept or from the equivalent transmission line section, the characteristic impedance would be Z load minus Z naught over Z load plus Z naught. Z load here is Z naught D and Z naught here is Z naught A. So the reflection coefficient is Z naught D minus Z naught A over Z naught D plus Z naught A. By applying these values of Z naught D and Z naught A, we obtain the reflection coefficient as minus 0.316. This how to calculate or how to solve this microwave network without the need of solving Maxwell equation. Here we have solved just simple transmission line network, but by using the equivalent circuit or the equivalent voltage, equivalent current, and equivalent impedance. And here the equivalent impedance is the wave impedance obtained from the full wave solution for these waveguides, which already has been obtained from the analysis of the waveguide. Hopefully this example will clarify what is the advantage of using network analysis in microwave circuits. Okay. Okay, what will be the situation if I'm talking about one port network? In the case of one port network, assuming we have a network, what is it? Doesn't matter. Maybe an antenna, maybe a resonator, it may be a load, any sort of network. And this network is connected to a transmission line section. So the potential at the port of the network and the current at the port of the network can be represented in terms of the transverse electric field component and transverse magnetic field component at the port of the network. In this case, the power transmitted to the network equals half the integration over the surface, the closed surface. And effectively, the closed surface here, the tangential electric field can be zero, but we are interested in the field or at the board. So the integration over the surface E cross H conjugate dot ds. And this integration will introduce real and imaginary values. The real value would correspond to the power losses inside this one board network, while the imaginary value would correspond to the stored electric and magnetic energy inside this one port network. Now, assuming that we are going to represent the transverse electric field and the transverse magnetic field in terms of equivalent voltage and current multiplied by the modal function of the electric field E as a function of X and Y and the modal function of the magnetic field H as a function of X and Y. And assuming that these modal functions are normalized, such as the integration over closed surface E equals H dot ds equal unity, in this case, the integration of, or the power is actually, is the integration of the voltage multiplied by the current conjugate. So, power is half V multiplied by I conjugate E cross H conjugate dot ds. V and I are constant with respect to the surface, so they can be taken outside the integration. The remaining part is the integration of the modal function E cross H conjugate, and E cross H conjugate is assumed to be normalized such that to be unity. This means that the power is half the equivalent voltage multiplied by the conjugate of the equivalent current. So half VI conjugate equals the power losses plus the stored electric and magnetic energy. The impedance, the input impedance, is defined as the ratio of the voltage to the current. And the input impedance in general is a complex quantity. The real part is the resistance and the imaginary part is the reactance. This input impedance, it can be represented as VI conjugate over the modulus of I squared, because the modulus of I squared is actually I multiplied by I conjugate. So this means that I have multiplied both the numerator and the denominator by I conjugate. This would correspond to VI conjugate over I squared. But we already proved that the power is half VI conjugate. This means that this actually is twice the power, or power over half. So power over half I squared and the power equals the dissipated power V loss plus the stored energy, which is 2J omega Wm minus We. This is the total power over half I squared. This is the definition of the input impedance. The real part here corresponds to the resistance, and the imaginary part here corresponds to the reactance. This means that the resistance of one port network equals the power dissipated in this network over the equivalent current squared multiplied by 2. And the equivalent reactance X equals twice the stored energy over I squared, where the stored energy is 2 omega multiplied by Wm minus We. Wm is the stored magnetic energy and We is the stored electric energy. If the stored magnetic energy is greater than the stored electric energy, this corresponds to inductive effect. On the other hand, if the stored electric energy is greater than the stored magnetic energy, this corresponds to capacitive effect. So the definition of the resistance and reactance in terms of the dissipated power in the network and stored energy in the network and the equivalent current at the port of the network is given by this relation. This is the concept or the definition of the impedance of one port network. Okay. All right.